Karma as the evolution of patterns. What is karma? The peripatetic Kagyu teacher Kenpo Tsultrum defines karma as physical, verbal, or mental acts that imprint habituated tendencies in the mind. Classically, Buddhism assumes that all actions are volitional. Psychoanalysis, behaviorism, and other modern psychological theories assume the opposite, that all actions are conditioned. Neither of these views is completely true. All of us have had the experience of acting in ways that we did not intend when anger, love, greed, or shame dictated our actions. All of us have had the experience of acting volitionally when we went against all our impulses and conditioning, somehow knowing what had to be done and just doing it. The meditations presented here have two aims: to expose how habituated patterns rule much of our lives and to show how we can end their tyranny. Four characteristics are associated with patterns: mechanicality, resonance, crystallization, and habituation. Mechanicality captures the automatic, non-volitional nature of patterns. Resonance describes how patterns absorb the energy of attention and cause attention to decay. Crystallization refers to the formation of internal structures that propagate the mechanical operation of patterns from moment to moment. Habituation is the accumulation of energy in the operation of a pattern. In other words, the more it runs, the stronger it becomes. By way of an example, a person I know is adept at attracting attention. In every situation, he finds a way to crack a joke, make an astute comment, raise a personal health issue, or offer advice. Outgoing, entertaining, and interesting, he is unable to be part of a group or event without at some point drawing attention expressly to himself. The pattern had crystallized to such an extent that he consistently justified his behavior as being helpful, raising legitimate concerns, introducing important insights, or providing entertainment. Most of the time, his actions were helpful. He and I discussed this behavior, and he insisted that it was volitional. Not convinced, I suggested that he make an explicit effort to refrain from drawing attention to himself at the next social event he attended. A short time later, he went to a dinner party with a group of friends. Everyone else was engaged in a lively conversation, but the subject matter was one he did not know well. The feeling of being left out resonated with the core of the pattern that demanded attention. He forgot our discussion, and the pattern started to run mechanically. He introduced a highly controversial topic, derailing the previous discussion, and became the center of attention, arguing his case passionately, even though he ended up taking a position contrary to his own professed values. Later that evening, after he had left the party, he realized that he had no interest in the topic per se, and couldn't justify the position he had been espousing. He realized that, at least on this occasion, his behavior was not volitional, and that the pattern was more deeply habituated than he had thought. The meditations in this chapter bring attention to the nature and operation of conditioned patterns. The patterns are revealed as self-organizing and self-perpetuating autonomous structures that function to degrade attention. They form in response to an experience too powerful to face. They develop into conditioning, and they continue to elaborate throughout our lives. Large areas and long periods of our lives are determined not by our volition, but by the operation of such patterns. Suffering is inevitable, because patterns bring about precisely the experiences that we are trying to avoid. The meditations show how to apply attention in order to dismantle habituated patterns and create the possibility of volitional action. The result is original mind, an unfettered mind that allows us to live in awareness and act volitionally. Fundamental change does not take place without strong motivation. So teachers through the ages have emphasized motivation over technique. The purpose of the meditations on death and impermanence is to dismantle attachment to conventional success in order to shape a suitable internal environment for spiritual practice. The purpose of the meditations on karma is to dismantle the belief that each of us is an autonomous self that acts rationally and volitionally. When we see clearly to what extent conditioning runs our lives, we are strongly motivated to go further in dismantling the patterns that form and shape our experience.